in search of the optimized transmit magnetic loop. Now, by the way, this anything I'm going to say here will apply to a loop used for receive. A lot of people use magnetic loops just for receive. They have some good properties for that. But this is about using a magnetic loop for transmitting and, of course, receive if you want to. But what about the term optimized? This is not a term we normally hear associated with the magnetic loop. We see a lot of magnetic loops, but nobody ever thinks about, is that an optimized loop? But that's a much more significant piece of information than you may realize to get the optimized loop. Well, here are some magnetic loops. This is just a sampling of magnetic loop pictures I took off the internet. Just searching around, I found these 25 pictures or whatever they are, 3 times 18 pictures. Some of these loops are good. Most of them are poor. And some of them are terrible. And one or two of them are pretty good. But most of them aren't very good at all. And we're going to show you why. Because most of those loops aren't optimized. The magnetic loop has been a real favorite with hams, but only since 1968, because it's a comparative newcomer into the ham radio world. Most other ham antennas date back into the 1930s, but the magnetic loop did not appear in ham radio until 1968. We'll see a little history on that in a minute. But it's been very, very popular because it's small. Even a little 3 or 4 foot loop can do wonderful things and can compete very favorably with big loops, big antennas that people might have some difficulty hiding in their attic or keeping away from neighbors. And they're generally easy to build, mostly made out of hardware store material. And of course, because they are new and fascinating to the ham community, there are many articles. I mean, many. I can't believe how many there are on the internet. But as I look at them, and as you study them carefully, and as you'll learn to do from this presentation, very few of them are optimized. Most of them are just one not very knowledgeable designer copying the work of another not very knowledgeable designer. Most of the designs of mag loops you see on the web, that one of which you may have even built. So I don't want to step on anybody's toes, but this will step on toes, this presentation, because it's going to show where some of the shortcomings and why most of the ones you see in the background are not optimized. And of course, there are commercial versions, some of which aren't very well optimized either. And because there are so many non-optimized loops out there, and because the ham community is moderately new to mag loops, there's a lot of disappointment out there. Sometimes they work well and sometimes they don't, or people build them and they think they should do wondrous things and they don't. So disappointment is not uncommon, but it's due to the fact that the loop isn't optimized. And they find that there's a lot of loss in the loop that they hadn't expected. They find, unfortunately, that building one of them can be quite expensive and buying one can be terribly expensive. And so that's a bit of a disappointment to many people. Also, some of them aren't that easy to build. How to do it isn't very well laid out on the internet because the ham community is still relatively new to the mag loop. Maybe in another 20 or 30 years, the thing will mature, but it's not mature yet. One of the main reasons for disappointment, though, and it's because very few builders and buyers of magnetic loops are aware of something rather important here, that magnetic loops have frequency limits. They have an upper frequency limit and a lower frequency limit. And if that you violate those or try to violate them, you're going to be disappointed. And of course, one of the worst things about magnetic loops is they're ugly. They're strange looking things. And so this neighbor here, this friendly looking guy with his pitchfork, no, he's right there staring over the ferret, doesn't particularly like the look of that funny looking thing in your backyard. He doesn't want it next to his backyard. But I've got good news for you. Optimizing a magnetic loop is not difficult. You just need to know how to do it. And most hams don't know how to do it. And most hams are building magnetic loops based on designs from other loop builders who also don't know how to optimize a magnetic loop. We're going to learn how. But now, why is it such a difficult thing to optimize, you say? It isn't difficult, but why is it a problem? It's because there's a lot to it compared to most other antennas. Take an ordinary dipole. This is not an ordinary dipole, but it is a dipole, piece of coax, and a couple of linear radiators, a linear antenna, full-size, half-wave dipole. How many factors are there to optimize a dipole? Really, just one. How long you make it? All that most hams ever concern themselves much about in building dipoles is to run the typical formula. What is it? 470-something divided by 300 divided by 474. That'll tell you the length. You cut a piece of wire that long, and you got an optimized dipole. But it isn't that easy for a mag loop. Believe me, it's far from that easy. There are, in fact, six factors to optimize with a mag loop. And here they are. Conductor diameter. That leads to the minimum size limit of the mag loop. And yes, there is a minimum size limit. You shouldn't make them smaller than a certain size. The material you build them out of. There's an optimum material to build magnetic loops. And it isn't what most of you may be thinking, who may be, have visions of sugar plums dancing in your head. No, visions of copper pipe dancing in your hair. That isn't the optimized material. The shape of the loop. Most of you think you know what shape a magnetic loop should be, but frankly, it isn't the optimum shape. The maximum size. Yes, there's a maximum size. You can't make them bigger than a certain amount. Lots of people don't know this. They think magnetic loops will tune any frequency. Yes, they can be made, but not one loop. And then how do you match the loop? Matching the loop is a very important factor in optimizing it, and also tuning the loop, because the methods that are used for tuning in most magnetic loops that you see today, and most of the ones you saw in my previous picture, are far, far from optimized, if for nothing more than they cost a fortune. I'm going to show you how to build a magnetic loop that doesn't cost a fortune for the tuning capacitor. All right, let's look at the factors. Number one, conductor diameter, which also leads to the minimum size that you should make the loop. And believe me, if you get nothing but this one section of this presentation, when you go to build or buy a magnetic loop, you're going to have your hands on the biggie. This is the one, bar none, you need to pay the most attention to. Let's take a look at a 4-foot square loop. Square doesn't matter, as we'll see. Just a 4-foot loop. Here's a 4-foot loop, but let's make it out of three different diameters of material. 10-inch wire, which a novice builder might think he could use by putting it inside of a PVC framework. RG8. RG8 is commonly recommended as the material to build a loop out of, because of that nice heavy braid on the outside of the RG8. It's not an optimized material. A 2-inch pipe. 2 inches big, yes, for a 4-foot loop. But notice what happens when you've just changed the diameter of the material that you build this 4-foot loop out of. What bands you can cover. If you use RG8, the best you can get down to is 15 megahertz. Or you might be able to get it down there. You might be able to tune it lower, but it won't work worth a darn below that frequency. It'll have so much loss. If you made it out of number 10 wire, you couldn't get it below 23 megahertz. Otherwise, the loss would be terrible. Notice that the pink area in this chart is the 50% loss level. There's no official how much loss you can tolerate in a loop, but 50% is reasonable to tolerate up to that much, because that's one S point. That's not a terrible loss. The distance below that, though, the loss is terrible. Notice, for example, how quickly the loss increases as the frequency goes down with a loop and as the size of the conductor goes down. So a 2-inch diameter pipe or conductor in a 4-inch square or round loop is about a minimum frequency that you should consider running. And it doesn't quite even make 40 meters. It makes it close enough. Maybe make it a little bigger, make it 2.5 inches or 3, and it would make 40 meters with 50% efficiency. But notice how much the size of the conductor in a magnetic loop determines what the lowest usable frequency is. Oh, yes, you might have a knob up there on your tuner that'll let you tune it down lower. Or you may believe the false idea that you can tune a loop to any frequency you want to just with a bigger capacitor. Yes, you can get low SWR, but you won't get low workable efficiency. This is the efficiency issue here. 2 inches for a 4-inch or a 4-foot loop. That's the minimum size you need for a decent magnetic loop. Not RG8 and certainly not number 10 wire. 2-inch actually takes you down to 9 megs on a 4-foot loop with a little bit of extra size or a little bit more compromise going down one more S point. You can get down to 40 meters. Even with 2 inches, it's amazing how large you've got to make the conductor to make a magnetic loop not be a disappointment. Undersized conductors, and you've seen what they are the chief mistake of magnetic loop builders. They think because, oh, that hula hoop would look like it'd make a great magnetic loop, and I'll stick a piece of number 10 wire inside of it, and I'll have a great magnetic loop. Forget it, Charlie. You've got a piece of junk. Even this famous loop, which a lot of you know about, maybe some of you even own one of these at $720, which is not exactly a small price. Well, pretty well built for MFJ, and not a bad loop. This one will tune down below 20 meters, but it isn't any good below 20 meters. It has unacceptable loss below 20 meters because that conductor size is too small. It just won't make it down below 20 meters without great loss in efficiency, high loss. Here are the actual figures for the MFJ loop. I ran these. But they're legitimate figures. It shows you the efficiency of this MFJ loop on the bands from 2 megahertz, 160 meters, up to 10 meters. And of course, at the high end, magnetic loops are pretty efficient. But notice how the efficiency of this MFJ loop falls off. Even down at 10 megahertz, it's down to 16% efficient. It isn't very, very usable much below about 20 meters. Oh, you can tune it down there, and you can make contact with it. I mean, you make contacts with a rubber ducky, don't you? That's not an efficient antenna. But is it efficient? No, it's not. So why does this lower limit exist? What are the reasons why that fall off is so great, so terrible, why there's such loss as you go down in large in conductor size or in the size of the loop? Well, here's some simple physics. If you don't deal with physics terribly well, you can sleep through this, but I think you'll find this reasonably understandable. Here's the schematic diagram of all antennas, whether it be a big Yagi or whether it be a little dipole or a rubber ducky, no matter what it is. It's got these four elements inside of it, these four theoretical elements inside of it. All are what are called loads. They all load the transmitter, meaning that the power from the transmitter has to pass through all four of them because all of them are in series. Two reactances, this is inductance and capacitance, they're not a problem because they don't use any of the power. But the ones on the right, R sub C, conductor resistance, and R sub R are where the efficiency and the loss takes place. These are the guys in all antennas, whether it be a great big log periodic or a little tiny magnetic loop, all of the loss occurs in one of those two resistances in the antenna. Conductor resistance, R sub C, or radiation resistance called R sub R. Don't know what radiation resistance is? Stand by for a minute, we're gonna explain it a bit. It's not too well known to most hams, but if you're gonna build magnetic loops, you ought to come to understand what radiation resistance is. It's an important factor in designing magnetic loops. not such an important factor in bigger antennas, but in little antennas, very important. Conductor resistance, which is just typical ohmic resistance that you can read with an ohmmeter, R sub C, conductor resistance. When the power from your transmitter passes through it, only thing it can do is to make heat. It's a demon. It's the bad boy of all antennas. It's what we don't want, because a hot antenna doesn't make contacts. What we want to have happen in an antenna is we want the power to be consumed by the radiation resistance, which it can only do in proportion to the conductor resistance. So if the radiation resistance is low and the conductor resistance is high, the efficiency is terrible, and vice versa, of course. It's the radiation resistance that makes the radio waves. And as you go down in size, here's the nasty point about small loop antennas. This is what eats us alive in small loops if we don't pay attention. When you go down in size in any antenna, anything you do to make an antenna smaller, put loading coil in it, put a capacity hat on it, bend it, fold it, you know, roll it up into a coil, anything you do to make that antenna smaller will take the conductor resistance down, but only directly. So a half-size antenna made smaller in any way, just even folding it up a little bit, make it half the size, it'll have half the conductor resistance, but it'll only have one quarter the radiation resistance, because radiation resistance goes up as the square of the size reduction. So a half-size antenna is half as efficient as a full-size efficient by nature. So if nothing else, if you don't learn any of that stuff, that physics stuff, you learn nothing else, I want you to take a snapshot of the next picture I'm going to show you. Embed this one. Get out a chisel and a hammer and chisel this on the memory of your mind so that you remember this picture if you're ever going to build magnetic loops. Here is an optimized magnetic loop. This magnetic loop has low loss. And why does it have low loss? Because it has big, fat conductors. That's as small in proportion to the size of the loop as you dare make a magnetic loop if you don't want to be disappointed by it. So take a mental picture of that loop. It's out in my backyard, that particular loop, made out of PVC and aluminum foil, which we'll get to in a minute here. That's an efficient loop all the way down to almost 40 meters. It's a 4-foot loop, by the way. Now, the rule of thumb to put in your mind, the maximum to memorize, and memorize it for good, you want to make an efficient magnetic loop. The diameter of the loop compared to the diameter of the conductors has to be no larger than 24 to 1. So what does that mean in a 4-foot loop? 2-foot pipe. That's the ratio, 24 to 1. If it's greater than that, if it's 1-foot pipe such that it's 48 to 1, it's not an efficient loop. So anytime you look at a loop, even at that MFJ loop, if it doesn't have that kind of fatness to it, it isn't a good loop. Here's a 440-meter loop, 4-foot in diameter, made with 2-foot pipe. If you want to go to 80 meters, if you want to keep this ratio, you're going to have to make an 8-foot loop, and you're going to have to make it with a 4-foot, 4-inch diameter pipe. That's a big pipe. Okay, factor number two. Now, I've been talking about bad stuff. Let's talk about something good, though. Skin effect. You might say, skin effect, that's good? Oh, yes. Skin effect is a big ally in making magnetic loops. Here's a piece of pipe, or a piece of rod, or a piece of wire. And you'll notice that the red is symbolic of the skin effect, the current running on the surface. We know that all AC or RF runs on the surface. It's a law of physics. I can explain why, but it's even heavier physics. But most hams know that RF or alternating current runs on the surface of conductors, not in the middle. Essentially, as you can see illustrated here, there's no current in the middle of the conductor. It isn't worth anything to the RF. RF doesn't care that there's anything in the middle. It could be pure vacuum or solid metal, and it won't work any better to RF. It only works because of the current on the surface. The current, the center, is not needed in a magnetic loop or in any antenna for that matter, even your great beam. That's why they can be made out of tubing, and it doesn't matter. They don't have to be made out of solid wire to work well. Of course, big beams don't matter because their radiation resistance is high, but small loops do matter. But in small loops, you don't need to make your magnetic loop out of solid conductor. You can make it out of something that's nothing or plastic. The center can be non-conductive, such as PVC pipe. Yes, you can make magnetic loops out of PVC pipe. That's what I made mine out of, and that's what they are. And the one I showed you in that picture is made out of 1.5 inch PVC pipe, which is almost 2 inches on the outside, covered with aluminum, self-adhesive aluminum foil. That works just as good if it was solid aluminum. Here you can see why. Here's the thickness of the skin for aluminum and for copper on the various ham bands, 80 meters, 40, 20, 10, 2 meters, and 70 centimeters. Notice how thin that skin is. Even for aluminum, which is thicker than copper, even at 80 meters, which is the worst case, the skin on the conductors is only 1.7 thousandths of an inch. A mil is a thousandth of an inch. At 440, the thickness of the skin running on the conductors is only 2/10,000ths of an inch thick. It has no need for the inside of the conductor at all. It could just as well be a vacuum, nothing, or PVC pipe, which is what I'm showing you here. Here's what I like to make my antennas out of. I make lots of antennas out of copper tape or aluminum tape. In fact, I do it all out of aluminum tape because, frankly, aluminum tape's just as good as copper. I'll show you why in a minute. But optimization of a magnetic loop, cost-wise, or cost optimization, because there's lots of optimizations, but cost optimization, which is better? 2 pieces of 1.5 inch PVC pipe at $17 each, or 2 pieces of copper pipe at $128 each? I think you don't take much brains to figure out which is more optimum. Aluminum foil on PVC is optimum. Copper pipe is not. Don't build your antennas out of copper pipe. You're wasting your money. You're not optimized. They may work well, but they've got a lot of disadvantages. Cost being number one. Weight being another one. Awkwardness being another one. Build them out of PVC and aluminum tape. Now, I told you why aluminum is just as good as copper. And you don't even need to use copper tape. Why? Because, yes, I know aluminum's less conductive than copper. 40% less conductive, but it has a skin that's almost twice as thick. So the ultimate effect of aluminum tape and copper tape are almost identical for building tape on PVC pipe antennas. Okay, factor three, the shape of the loop. Now, some of you think, oh, I know what shape a magnetic loop should be. No, you don't. Here's where you got the idea of the shape. It goes away, dates back to 1968. To an article that Lou McCoy, now a silent key, a luminary of ham radio, wrote dozens and dozens of wonderful articles on ham radio, saw an article by Ken Patterson of the U.S. Army, who developed this loop for the Vietnam War, which was an octagonal loop made out of 5 foot section bolted together in a 12-foot octagon, and was tuned with 3 variable capacitors. By the way, if you want this article, you can get it from the QST archive. Just go to qst.org or look for the QST archive and look for the old archive, and you'll find this article. Just search for the Army Loop. This is where I got this article. That's why the picture is so terrible. It's a Xerox copy. This is where the shape in most ham's mind of what a magnetic loop should look like got stuck. This shape got riveted, either a circle or an octagon. ask most hams, what shape should a magnetic loop, and they'll say round or octagonal. Nope, sorry, that's not the optimum shape. Here are three common shapes for a magnetic loop. Round, of course, and these are magnetic loops. And by the way, none of those are efficient loops. They've all got too small diameter. They're all made out of copper pipe. Yeah. They're not optimizers, but they show the three shapes of magnetic loops. Round, octagonal, like McCoy did it, or Patterson did it, or square. Most of you will say, oh, the magnetic loop should be one of the two on the left. Nope, should be the one on the right. That's the optimum shape of a magnetic loop, square. Why? For two really important reasons. First of all, a 3-foot square of the same area as a circle is only 4.5 inches bigger at the corners only. That's insignificant. Nobody cares whether your loop sticks out a little at the corners. Why go to the trouble to make it round? That's because McCoy said you should make it round. No, you shouldn't. You don't need to make it round. Round is too hard to bend. That's why most people are making it out of copper pipe, because they think they can bend it, or they can use solid pipe and 45-degree elbows. No, you don't need to do that. Besides, it's too small anyway. You should never make your loop that small and the conductor that small anyway. You should make it out of 2-inch pipe if you're going to make it this size. How are you going to bend a 4-foot or a 3-foot circle out of 2-inch copper pipe? Well, you're not going to in your home workshop. But can you make a 4-foot square loop out of the copper pipe that you buy at a hardware store? Of course you could. Or make it out of PVC pipe? Of course you can. Piece of cake. But an octagon or a circle is not a piece of cake. That's why I say square is the optimum mag loop shape. Because Michael Faraday learned back in the middle of the 1800, the great pioneer of radio learned, that magnetic loops, he studied them extensively. Magnetic loops don't care anything about their shape. They only care about the area inside of the loop. So if that round loop and that square loop and that octagonal loop have the same square area, they work absolutely the same. So why trouble yourself to try to make it round? It doesn't work any better, and yet is almost impossible to make, particularly if you make the conductor big enough. And the copper pipe and elbows, expensive as hell. Square is the easiest to build. It's the optimal shape. So if we're searching for the optimum loop, it's square. Now, I just throw you this as a little bit of history. Magnetic loops have kind of fallen out of favor in anything but ham radio, where they're very popular. They used to be used in the military. Here, by the way, is a whole bunch of magnetic loops that still in existence, but haven't been used in years, way on the southern tip of the British Isles, where the British military used them in an array. Of course, you can hook mag loops up in an array if you want to, and they use them as a cross X direction finding array. This worked very well, as a matter of fact. The military doesn't use mag loops either anymore. This is their loop antenna. This is not a mag loop. It's a non-resonant loop tuned up with an autocoupler. It's an HF antenna from 2 to 30 megahertz. It's a cloud burner and a pretty low efficiency antenna. All right, factor number 4, maximum loop size. You might think, oh, you mean a magnetic loop has a maximum loop size? Oh, yes, it does. If you want to work some bands, it does. It has a band size limit. To how high you can use it, depending upon how big you make it. Many ham loop builders don't even know this. Here's a maxim for you, another thing to put in memory. No magnetic loop size can work all the HF bands for transmit. Now, maybe for receive, you might get by with one loop that'll work to all the bands. But if you wanted a good, efficient transmitting loop for the HF bands, you're going to have to build more than one loop. A bigger loop and a smaller loop, or maybe 3 of them. Here's the maximum frequency that a loop can work. And you may wonder, why can it work this maximum frequency? I'll show you in a moment. If you're down at if you're down at two feet in diameter, or roughly 3 feet in diameter, you can get down to 30 megahertz or up to 30 megahertz with a magnetic loop. But if you come down to 4 feet in diameter, you can't get above 20 megahertz. If you come down to 6 feet in diameter, you can't get above 12 megahertz, and so forth, such that if you go down to a 12-foot loop like Patterson built, it won't go anything above about 8 megahertz. Of course, Patterson didn't use his loop above 8 megahertz. That's why it worked. Remember, magnetic loops have both an upper and a lower frequency limit. Lowest frequency by the efficiency. Upper frequency, here's 10 meters, here's 20 meters, here's 40 meters. You can make your loop big like this one. Here's a real well-known loop made in Italy, the Ciro Mazzioni automatic magnetic loop. That's about an 8-foot loop. 20 meters is the maximum that loop can work. No 15 meters, no 17 meters, no 10 meters, no 12 meters, and certainly no 6 meters on that loop. Probably will work 20 meters. That's all it'll work. Okay, let me show you two optimized example loops. One, I've already showed it to you, the 4-footer. That loop, that 4-foot loop, is what I call the epicenter loop, that meaning it's right in the middle of where most hams would find it useful. It'll work 10 to 40 meters with reasonable, there's a bit of loss on 40, but it'll work 10 to 40 quite reasonably well. And it's 4 foot in diameter, light in weight, made out of PVC and aluminum foil. It also in my backyard is this 2-foot loop. It's to get it up to 6 meters. I had to make it smaller. I had no choice. You can't make that 10-foot, that 4-foot loop resonate down there on 40 meters. And why? Because its self-resonant is as high as it can go. Here's the, I left that slide out, but here are the two loops, just to give you a little idea what they look like schematically. I put some ellipses in there so to shrink it down. So you can see the one on the left has 42-inch pieces of 1.5-inch PVC. The one on the right has 22-inch pieces of PVC, 1-inch PVC. And they both have elbows, and the elbows are cut in half vertically, so they can be aligned with aluminum foil on the inside and then screwed onto the pipe with sheet metal screws. And there's a gap in the middle of the thing. The gap is too small in this drawing. 1.5-inch works better. Gap is not critical. And down at the bottom, you can see that where it's fed, there's a little plastic plate down there with a PLSO239 on it, with a wire connecting over to the feed loop and some aluminum foil going down to the main loop. This is the basic structure. This is an optimum loop. It's optimum in all ways. The tuning assembly is rugged and robust, whereas most ways people tune these things with little flimsy coupling loops or with terrible to build gamma matches. I hate gamma matches. This is the efficient way, the optimum way to match a magnetic loop. It's called a tap match. Works very well. Kind of a modified gamma match, but an easy one to do. And the three little flattened end aluminum rods with bolts through the end let you adjust it very freely. You can adjust these loops no matter where you mount them and get it to come to a perfect one-to-one SWR. Now, some of you are going to say, hey, where's the beef? Where's the tuning capacitor? Notice what it says up at the top? Tuning capacitor not shown. Oh, it's there. I just don't show it in this drawing. In the upper one on the right, I show tuning capacitor, see text, because it looks more like that. The tuning capacitor is here, but it's inside of the loop. It's another piece of PVC pipe with aluminum foil on it that's pulled back and forth inside the loop to cross over the gap and change the capacity. Costs nothing and works just as well as multi-$100 vacuum variables or inefficient rotary capacitors. Don't bother with those. They're a waste of time. They're way, way, way from optimum. This is the optimum capacitor or something like it. Here's, by the way, how you put the aluminum foil on the pipe. It's a little difficult, so you just have to stick the ends down by folding the end over and stick some of the sticky onto a piece of carpet, and then put the plastic pipe down slowly and carefully on the aluminum foil tape. This is 4-inch tape going onto a piece of 1.5-inch PVC. I use the same tape on the 1-inch PVC. And what you do is, if you put it down this way, stick the ends down, then pull the covering off, and then slowly and carefully and accurately put the pipe down slowly in the middle, then snip the ends off. You can just gently roll the pipe back and forth, and you'll put that foil on as smooth as goose grease. You try to just stick it on by pulling the backing on and sticking it on by eye. You'll make a mess. And here are the elbows. You have to put the aluminum foil on the inside of the elbows. I tried it on the outside, but it's a pain in you know what. Put it on the inside. A good friend of mine, W6OEK, said, don't put it on the outside, put it on the inside. So I tried it and it works fine. Cut a little L-shaped piece, slowly put it inside the inside, carefully smooth it down, and you can get it inside. Then when you put the PVC pipes with the foil on it, they mate against these smooth curved surfaces and are held together with sheet metal screws. Works great, makes good contact, no loss at all to speak of. The tuning capacitor. Here's a schematic diagram of the two, one for the big loop, one for the small loop, one for the 10 through 40 loop made out of 1.5-inch pipe, and one for the 6 and 10 meter loop made out of 1-inch pipe. Inside the big loop is a piece of 1.5-inch pipe, a 1-inch PVC pipe, slightly fattened at the end with some cardboard to make it have a little more capacity. And the one that's at the bottom is just a piece of ordinary 1/2-inch PVC pipe with foil around it that's simply pushed in and out of the pipe with a longer piece of PVC pipe. You don't have to push it very far. Just that area in red is as far as you have to pull it. And you can tune it from 6 meters to 10 meter very easily. How do you tune it? You take an antenna analyzer out to your antenna, and you pull it until you get a low SWR. That's simple. Here's the movable capacitor inside the big loop. You can see it's a piece of 1.5-inch PVC pipe. I mean, 1-inch PVC pipe, fattened at one end to give me, I needed a little more capacity. And it has a piece of braid to hook it to one end. I needed more capacity to cover all the way from 40 to 10, but this will do it. Here you can see the tuning here that I did quickly. You can get it lower than this, by the way. I got the 10 meter end down quite low there, my vector network analyzer, I got the one at 40 meters down to about 2.5 to 1. You can get it down to 1 to 1. I just didn't take the time to do it. And you can see the fact that that tuning capacitor will tune below the 6 meter band, but above the 10 meter band. So you can tune everything and everything in between. Here's one of the elbows. You can see it's been cut vertically with a bandsaw, and there's the sheet metal screws that hold it together. Lined inside with aluminum foil and some paracord sticking out of the end that pull the capacitor back and forth. It's easy to tune. There have been various automated ways to do this. I'm not trying to show the automated way. You can use stepper motors and other things. I'm not going to go into that here, but you can certainly do that. So this tuning capacitor has a couple of advantages. First of all, it's perfectly protected from the weather. You don't need to put it in any kind of a box or anything. The pipe protects it. And it's got a high voltage rating. 2,000 volts is about as much as you'll ever get on that capacitor on the big loop on 40 meters. And the PVC pipe is more than up to the 2,000 volts. Matching. You can match the loop in one of three ways. You can do what a lot of people do. They use a small separate coupling loop. That was my favorite until I realized that's flimsy. Or you can use a toroid and use a smaller loop. That's hard to design. And a gamma match. I hate gamma matches. They're hard to build and hard to adjust. As I say, they're difficult. The little coupling loop on the left works well, but it's flimsy and hard to mount. The ferrite is a bugbear for all hams. most hams hate ferrite, although they use them, but they use it by cookbook and formula. They don't know how to figure it out. So here's the optimum magnetic loop, and here's the transformer, the coupling loop on the big loop, and the smaller one has smaller little arms. This one's not flimsy, very rigid. Once you tighten those nuts down, I use wing nuts, as a matter of fact. And you might ask, do you have to change that very much? No. Like most antennas, tune it up on one band. Get the SWR low, and it'll go over to the other bands with changing the SWR very little. At most, you might have to tweak it a little. But chances are you won't need to bother the matching once you get it set on one band. So the epicenter loop, as far as I'm concerned, is a 10 through 40 meter loop made out of 1.5 inch PVC pipe, which is 1.9 on the outside, or 1.95 with the foil on it. What shape is it? It's square. It's 4 feet. That'll allow you to go from 40 meters to 10 meters. Make it bigger and you won't go high, that won't go high enough. Make it smaller and you won't go low enough. It's got frequency limits. That's why 4 feet is about the optimum. The material, don't make it out of solid copper pipe. Waste of money, waste of time. Not necessary, completely unnecessary. Foil tape does everything that on PVC pipe does everything solid copper pipe will do for you. Don't make your mag loops out of copper pipe. Tuning and matching, use the little triple rigid, three rigid pipe with flattened ends and screws through the end. That's the rigid way to do it. That's the good way to do it. That's the optimum. That's the optimum loop. So if you build one, send me some pictures, or if you get any greater ideas on how to maybe automate the capacitor a little bit so you can tune it from the shack, send me some pictures. I love to get feedback. And by the way, don't forget to vote for my August article in QSD. So that's it, folks. This is my little doggy Lolly. She's a Shih Tzu. She's sleeping over here about 10 feet away right now. No, she does not have a German call sign. I just like to say her call sign is Doggy, D-0-G-G-Y. Want to get a hold of me? There's a QR code there you can take a picture of, and that'll take me to my website and to my email address, jportune@aol.com, or to w6nbc.com, where you'll see the other topics that I'm glad to talk on. And that's it, folks. Magnetic loops. I may have stepped on some toes, but I think you probably learned something.
Okay, John. Well, thank you. Jeff, have we put the drawing in yet? I was looking. I didn't see it.
Yes, we did. And we have 6 entries so far.
Oh, we do? Okay. Well, good. Okay, John. Any short questions there for John before we give you guys a chance to go into the chat and put your name in for the $25 HRO certificate. So any questions?
Jerry, I think there's a question in the chat. They're asking height off the ground for the loops. Is there a optimized height off the ground?
No. Like any antenna, they generally will work better off the ground, but the mag loop is remarkably good working low. It tends to be a good performer low. It's not a miracle low antenna, but it is a good antenna low.
The other question,
there's a lot more to be said about them, but I didn't have the time.
The other question, John, was how much power can the capacitor handle?
All the power you can throw at it. And the 2,000 volts that I showed you was at full legal limit, by the way.
Okay.
No, it'll handle everything your linear will put out.
Okay. And let's see, any other questions? I'm looking. We got those two.
Some people ask me how much power will foil tape handle? That's a question I usually get, so I'll just answer it here for you. I'm going to use the Socrates method or the Socratic method of answering a question with a question. Let me ask you a question. A piece of 3/8 inch aluminum tubing. Will that handle power? A piece of 3/8-inch aluminum tubing has exactly the same power handling capacity as a piece of 1-inch wide aluminum tape 1.5 mils thick. Because of the skin effect, they're absolutely identical. So don't worry about the foil tape burning up if you put power into it. It won't.
Okay, good, good. Any other questions? How are we doing on the drawing, Jeff?
10 entries so far.
10, anybody, last call here to get in on the drawing. We've got 10 so far. So again, remember our Ham Fest, August 28th, and remember to go in and look at the volunteer section and see what you can, where you can help us. It's not hard. It just takes a little time, and it's fairly early in the morning, but sure appreciate anybody that can help us out, help the club out. We about where we're going to go, Jeff?
Okay, I see another question up there. Bob Messenbring asks.
Okay, do you have to retune when moving around in the band?
No. There's a general rule about antennas. Once you retune, yes, you may have to retune the frequency, but not the SWR. It'll stay pretty flat. In fact, it stays pretty flat across the entire range of this antenna. Yes, you may have to retune in the band. What my biggest fan, WK5DCC, his name is Denny, he lives in Arkansas, he built a bunch of these, worked all over the world with these loops. He simply took the paracord that came out of the end of the ends, rolled it back over a couple of little pulleys, and brought it back and tied the ends together and put a little marker on the paracord and put up a little scale so he can move it and take care of the tuning without having to take a meter out there to retune. But it's narrow. Any mag loop is narrow. That's physics. That's not the design. That's not this loop. Any mag loop is narrow. You have to retune them.
Okay. Good deal. I don't see anybody else popping up there. Where are we at there, Jeff? We ready to roll?
We got 11 entries. I can spin it now if we're ready.
Last call. Anybody want to get in? Go in the chat. Give you a second there. And if it doesn't change, we'll go with it. We're still at 11?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's it. Spin it.
All right. Let me randomize range. And the winner comes up as Frankie Freeman, KC0JAV.
KC0JAV, Frankie. Okay, Frankie. Congratulations. We will hopefully you're good in our roster, good in QRZ, and we will mail you the certificate. Congrats, John. Thank you. Always a pleasure to have your presentations. You got some great ones, so I'm sure we'll have you back again sometime. Thank you very much.
All right. All the best. We'll see you down the old coax.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And with that, I guess unless there's any final questions for me or anybody else, we'll say good night. We had, I think, about 27 tonight, a little bit lighter than some nights, but it's summertime, so vacation time. Anyway, thank you all. And see you next time. Remember Hamfest. Jeff, thanks for setting it up.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Perfect. Thank you, guys. Bye. Have a good night.
Okay. Night.
All right, everyone. Thank you all for being here again this evening, K1DVC. So, yeah. Here we go. Yep. w0tx.org for more information on our club. Glad to have everyone here. This evening's meeting and Elmer session, both available, youtube.com/Denver Radio Club. So, yeah, everyone have a good evening, and we will talk soon. Take care. Maybe.
NBC Television.